There's something about an unsolved mystery that captures every imagination. On the 24th of March 1899, Edward Elgar wrote to his publisher to say that Hans Richter had agreed to conduct the first performance of a new set of variations for orchestra that he had finished at the end of February of that year. The manuscript had passed from Elgar to Richter, then back to his publishing house in London, where it was looked after by Elgar's friend and colleague, Augustus Jaeger. It was during this time that, following a request from Elgar, a single word was added to the score, above the theme. A simple word, written in Jaeger's hand, but one that began a 100-year hunt for a mystery concealed inside one of the most famous pieces of music ever written. The word was, of course, Enigma. The individual variations are in themselves cryptic in nature. Each movement acts, as Elgar puts it, as a sketch of the composer's friends. But the identity of each person was, at the time of its premiere, hidden behind initials or nicknames known only to the composer. Jaeger, for example, is the dedicatee of the most famous movement in the work, Nimrod. So called because the surname Jaeger comes from the German word for hunter, and in the Old Testament, Nimrod is described as a mighty hunter before the Lord. But this was not the most interesting riddle that the piece presented. C.A. Barry, who had seen proofs of the manuscript and who had the task of putting together the program note for the first performance, asked Elgar to clarify the meaning of the word written above the theme. "The enigma I will not explain. Its dark saying must be left unguessed. And I warn you that the apparent connection between the variations and the theme is often of the slightest texture. Further, through and over the whole set, another and larger theme goes, but is not played. So the principal theme never appears." This is one of only a handful of occasions that Elgar wrote or spoke publicly about the enigma. A year after the premiere, in an interview for the Musical Times, Elgar added that the heading Enigma is justified by the fact that it is possible to add another phrase, which is quite familiar, above the original theme. Then, in 1911, for a performance in Italy, he wrote that the work contains sketches of the composer's friends. It may be understood that these personages comment or reflect on the original theme, and each one attempts a solution of the enigma. And finally, to accompany the publishing of the piano roll in 1929, Elgar wrote brief notes on each of the movements, where he said things like, "The drop of the seventh in the theme should be observed," and talking about the tenth movement, "The inner sustained phrases, at first on the viola and later on the flute, should be noted." Apart from a few other brief comments in letters and interviews, and the information gleaned from Elgar's love of cryptic clues and ciphers, this is it. This and the score itself is everything that he provided to work out his enigma. During Elgar's lifetime, the solutions to the enigma mostly focused on finding a melody that would fit above or act as counterpoint to the original theme. Various suggestions were made, from the national anthem to Auld Lang Syne, but they were all flatly denied by Elgar. It was really only after his death in 1934 that the solutions started to become more elaborate. In July of the same year, Richard Powell, the husband of Dora Penny, the dedicatee of Variation 10, published his theory, suggesting that the principal theme was actually Auld Lang Syne. This was despite Elgar's repeated denials that this melody was correct. Regardless, Powell suggested that because of the nature of the friends that Elgar chose to depict in each variation, the melody for the principal theme was not likely to be religious or classical. Most of them didn't share his Catholicism, and not all of them were musical. Auld Lang Syne, as Powell puts it, has peculiar associations with the idea of friendship, so it acts as a larger metaphorical unifier for the piece. As well as providing a melody that could work in counterpoint with the opening G minor theme. To do this, Powell rewrites Auld Lang Syne in a minor mode for the beginning and end sections, and begins the melody an eighth note before the enigma theme to account for the upbeat. As the years passed, each new solution to the enigma became increasingly complex and detailed, involving more elaborate justifications. In 1976, almost 80 years after the first performance, Theodore Van Houten, a Dutch-British writer and journalist, suggested a multifaceted approach to explain why the patriotic song Rule Britannia is the hidden principal theme. His answer started from a musical standpoint, comparing the contours of the melody sung to the word never in Rule Britannia to the opening four notes of the Enigma theme. This was hinted at, according to Van Houten, by Elgar's use of the word never twice in his 1899 program note. On top of this, he believed the solution was corroborated by the often quoted line from Elgar that Dora Penny, of all people, should be able to guess the theme. Dora's surname points you towards the duodecimal penny coin, which, until 1970, showed the figure of Britannia on the reverse side, holding Neptune's trident and shield. Things started to get even more involved after the turn of the century. In the late 2000s, Robert Padgett, a music teacher and self-taught composer from Texas, took it upon himself to solve the enigma. In more than 100 detailed, labyrinthic blog posts, he puts forward the 16th century Lutheran hymn, Ein Festeburg ist unser Gott, as the true identity of the missing theme. Padgett's answer is astonishingly complex. He starts by identifying what he believes are multiple references within the music and score to the name of the hymn, the three letters E, F, and B, or some translated version of the name. Here are some examples. In Variation 13, the only variation whose dedicatee is hidden, Elgar quotes a three-note phrase from a Mendelssohn overture, twice in A-flat major, once in E-flat major, and a final time in F minor. The three keys minus the flats gives us A, E, and F, which hints, with some remixing of the letters, at the F-A-E sonata written collaboratively by Schumann, Brahms, and Dietrich for the violinist Joseph Joachim. Joachim was a Lutheran, leading us to Martin Luther's Ein Festeburg. Mendelssohn was also a supporter of the work of the young composer Joseph Joachim Raff, who, although no relation to the violinist, wrote a concert overture on Ein Festeburg. The four quotations in Variation 13 also suggests, according to Padgett, that we need to look for the principal theme in the fourth movement of some other Mendelssohn work, and in the fourth movement of his Reformation Symphony, he quotes Ein Festeburg. In English, Ein Festeburg means a mighty fortress. The three keys for the quotations in Variation 13 are A, E, and F, minus the flats. E rotated 90 degrees gives us an M, so we're left with A, M, and F. There's even more. The opening Enigma theme has two key signatures, G minor and G major. G minor has two flats in the signature, B flat and E flat. G major has one sharp, F sharp. Minus the accidentals, we get B, E, and F, which rearranged gives us EFB. The performance directions at the beginning of the Enigma theme are andante, legato e sostenuto, piano, and molto espressivo. Taking the first letters from each word and two from espressivo, you get an anagram for EE's psalm. EE for Edward Elgar, and psalm because Ein Festeburg gets its title from Psalm 46. But what about Elgar's dark saying? Padgett has an answer for that too. According to him, the cipher that Elgar planted in the score was hidden in the first six bars of the Enigma theme, indicated by the out-of-place double bar line in between bars 6 and 7. He suggests that by doing a frequency analysis of pairings of melody and bass notes in this section, of which there are 24, you can assign these pairs to the 24 letters that make up Ein Festeburg ist unser Gott. I won't go into detail about this here, but take it from me. Its explanation is incredibly elaborate, but ultimately unconvincing. After all of this, does Ein Festeburg actually work in counterpoint with the music of the Enigma variations? On top of Nimrod, it does. But over the Enigma theme itself? Not really. Not without significant manipulation of the melody. So where does this all leave us? No musical solution seems to be wholly satisfying, and the non-musical ones, like the suggestion that the answer is pi or the theme is friendship, are ultimately impossible to validify. Elgar was the only person who knew the truth. So any new solution to the enigma, regardless of the lengths to which someone will go to confirm their theory, can never be proved. But I think that this story of obsession, highlights a deeper issue with our approach to music theory and analysis. It paints retrospectively a picture of a genius composer creating elaborate, complex ciphers hidden inside every note and phrase of his music. Almost every theory that I've read neglects to recognize that behind this music is a fallible, anxious, and vulnerable human being. Composing, like creating any art, is an emotional and human process. To suggest that his first thoughts were how to painstakingly hide references to his hidden principal theme in the music is to misunderstand what a composer actually does, and how impossible it often is to write anything, let alone anything good. This approach not only contorts Elgar's practice of writing music, but also, more worryingly, has the potential to do lasting damage to the confidence of aspiring composers who might feel they could never reach his supposed level of genius. Elgar puts it best himself. "My idea is that there is music in the air, music all around us. The world is full of it, and you simply take as much as you require." For Elgar, music was a universal language open to everyone as listeners or composers. And I think that's how we should listen to his variations on an original theme. Yes, it's interesting to look at theories behind the enigma, but it doesn't mean that we should think of the variations as an intricate, complex work full of ciphers and riddles, but instead as one person's way of communicating with the world. What he's communicating, or even how he's doing it, at the end of all of this, doesn't really matter. What matters is how alive it makes us feel. Thank you so much for watching. I've really only scratched the surface of the solutions to the enigma here, so if you'd like to find out more about them and to form your own opinions, do take a look at some of the links that I put in the description below. As always, if you like this, subscribe to keep up to date with all my new videos, and I hope you enjoy exploring all the other essays on my channel. See you next time.